Hi, everyone. I'm Teresa Mangum. I'm the director of the Oberman Center for Advanced Studies here at the university. And thank you for coming to the final Oberman Conversations of the semester, titled The Cost of Success, Rap Music, Money, and Civics. I wanted to quickly introduce both of our speakers, and then off they'll go. But I also wanted to invite you, if you'd like to come next semester, the next of our discussions will be on February the 16th, and it will focus on how housing impacts the health of a community. It'll be at the Midwest Bank in their new public space on the sixth floor, and Sally Scott from Public Policy, Barbara Vaquero from Public Health, Marianne Dennis, who's the Executive Director of the Housing Fellowship in town, will all be there, again, with another conversation, in this case, about housing. I suspect a lot of you are here because you know these two great speakers, or conversationalists today. Michael Hill is a professor in the English Department in African American Studies, and whose research focuses on 20th and 21st century African American literature. He's the author of the book, The Ethics of Swagger, prize-winning African American novels, 1977 to 1993, which was published in 2013. And the book talks about the way black creative styles surface the difficulties of creating a multiracial democracy, especially focusing on the Reagan era. Michael received the Nick Aaron Ford Waters Edward Turpin Symposium Award on African American literature in 2013 for the book. He's now working on a project that I'm very proud the Oberman Center had a small part in supporting, that is tentatively titled Kinky Bourgeois, Sexual Initiation and Democratic Potential in Black Civil Rights Novels, that looks at the role of adolescence in black literature, African American literature of that period. But he also has another collection coming out that I am so excited about that is called Invisible Hawkeyes, Iowa Integration and the Ellisons from University of Iowa Press, that looks at all of the African Americans who've come through the creative disciplines, the performing disciplines, right here at the University of Iowa, interviews and discussions with those amazing artists that we'll learn a lot about soon. Michael also, as a lot of you know, is a real pillar in the local community too. On campus, he's a leader in the African American Council, but he's also a real go-to person for many, many people in this community when we need to learn. Andre Perry is, to many of us, a local celebrity. Even while he was going after his MFA in not creative nonfiction from the University of Iowa, Andre started transforming Iowa City. It probably first started for most of us with the Mission Creek Festival that he co-founded that now draws top artists and performers and huge audiences every year. I often marvel at the magic Andre weaves throughout the city. Just think about the hats he wears. Talent organizer at the Mill, executive director of the Englert. Many of you might not know, but I have learned to really listen. The curator of music at Pullman, and co-founder not only of Mission Creek, but now launched just a few weeks ago a new festival called The Witching Hour. He also performs himself in bands like Data Gun and The Lonely Hearts. Perhaps a quote from an interview in a Business Corridor Review article captures his generosity and vision best. When he was asked what he'd do if he had $1 million, Andre said, "I would funnel those resources back into the community, specifically helping those who have fewer opportunities to engage in educational experiences beyond the classroom, extracurricular activities, and exposure to and immersion in the arts." Let's thank both of our speakers.
In true hip-hop fashion, I'm gonna claim the mic first, and then I'm gonna do a drop. Oh, good. All right. The cost of success, rap music, money, and civics. Noah Smith, an assistant professor of finance at SUNY Stony Brook, recently tweeted that 80% of rap songs are just Horatio Alger stories, I was poor. Then I created high-quality entertainment products. Now I am rich. If his somewhat sarcastic post reflects rap's consistent concentration on the journey between poverty and wealth, then it also bespeaks an intriguing act of integration. Horatio Alger, the fin de siècle era symbol of triumphal individualism, represents a core narrative in mainstream American achievement. Hallmarking national perseverance and a can-do spirit in the industrial age, Alger is the gold standard of up by your bootstraps, anti-victimizing stars and stripes progress. Smith's conflation of youthful music making and Alger, a cherished emblem of national advancement, makes sense at the level of plot lines. However, his unperturbed combining contrast prevailing perspectives regarding the ethical imperatives of rap. Over the years, many voices have weighed in to declare the enrhymed musical arm of hip-hop culture a debased art form. The manifest text of such critiques laments the profanity, the misogyny, and more recently, the homophobia of the music. Although all of these instances of naysaying merit scrutiny, for my present purposes, I am most interested in those detractors who emphasize the materialism in rap. Bill O'Reilly, Kevin Powell, and Juan Williams summited on the corrupting culture in the music, and as part of the discussion, Williams lambasted rap lyricists as predatory pilferers who exploited the black community in a minstrel-like fashion, all for the sake of the almighty dollar. This broad brush précis of rap, where you trot out damning phrases from popular practitioners like Lil Wayne and Kanye West and titillating images of Nicki Minaj, constitutes for many right and left wing commentators a rationale for declaring rap a sphere bereft of progressive engagement. Rap in the mind of mainstream gatekeepers of American citizenship limns a precipitous decline, the arc of which is captured sonically in the shift from Motown to Def Jam. While it is tempting to embrace such neat analyses, to declare along with John McWhorter that rap's politics surface in its determination to exhibit the upturned middle finger for the sake of atmosphere, I want to glance again at the art form's narrative impulses. The music's aesthetics betray robust revelations tied to what I have called elsewhere the ethics of swagger. For our time together, I want to investigate three examples of rap music's handling of money to determine whether there might be a riddle nestled in the music's margins. Money in the rap imagination is a key that unlocks the door to success. As the notorious B.I.G. stated in his 1994 debut single, Juicy, the dream of every kid who used to read Word Up magazine was to get enough cash so that they too could floss like Salt and Pepper and Heavy D. The deep link between money and social uplift echoed mainstream ambitions, operating much like the Alger stories mentioned earlier. However, the inequities that conditioned black existence often meant that access to money-making could not keep pace with the alluring fantasies. In hip-hop, the gap between desire and access resulted in stories about wealth generated through illegal enterprises. KRS-One's Love's Gonna Get Ya, UGK's Pocket Full of Stones, Jizza's Cold World, all explore scenes where the drug game allows individuals to amass fortunes. Released during the 1990s, each of these songs shows that by the Clinton era, a tradition existed wherein rap's engagement with money evoked a connection to illegal activity. Perhaps this unsavory association explains why the widespread claim that rap glorifies illicit enterprises has so much currency in contemporary discussions. After all, listening to Pimp C of UGK opining that crack show pay good in the city set might give one the impression that he endorses, if not emulates, the behavior that he is chronicling. Where such debates might be vigorous at any moment, they rage with peculiar intensity in what one Martha's Vineyard symposium termed the age of crack. The voices in such contestations included folks like Abyssinian Baptist Church pastor Calvin Butts III, who in 1993 was prepared to run over rap CDs with a steamroller to protest their perniciousness. If outsiders looking in scrutinized rap's accounts of money making, then for a good while, the eyes of those who created the music had also been trained critically on such situations. Our first example clarifies this tendency. Aborted criminality, Eric B. and Rakim's Paid in Full. William Michael Griffin, the MC known as Rakim, has penned some of the most quoted lines in rap history. Boasting a prolific collection of catchy lyrical concoctions, he probed deceptively profound territory when he intoned in 1986 that he was this single verse song examines the intersection of economic ambition and crime. And instead of offering a speaker who capitulates to Easy Money's siren song, Rakim presents a persona that embraces righteousness. Far from being a simple choice born of a lifelong adherence to upright living, this decision surfaces as a byproduct of learning. He emphasizes that now he will walk in the narrow path that leads to salvation. Nevertheless, his present sentiments suggest a prior moment in which the quick fix of a holdup would rule the day. While Rakim offers us a handy chance to paint 1980s era hip hop as a golden age where the degraded tendencies of a later day have not yet corrupted the art form, I want to argue that in addition to glossing a more innocent incarnation of urban peril, the rapper also indicates a muscular moral negotiation. He ushers listeners into the ethical entanglements at the center of a culture and candidly insists that not all outcomes can be glibly predicted and transparently understood. For our tour through money in the hip-hop mind, Rakim's posture alerts us to pluralistic blackness, a worldview that suggests that even as black folks confront uniform conditions of deprivation, they manifest a range of reactions to such predictable situations. The reasons why variety prevails peek out in the latter portion of Rakim's verse. Poised between the renunciation of criminality and the prospect of striving and staying alive by getting a 9-to-5, the speaker in Paid in Full confesses that the mic magnetizes him. Confessing magnetism is one thing, but at the end of this song, he ups the ante by stating that he is willing to test his mic skills by hitting the studio and seeing if his music can be a route for him to get paid in full. I need to hurry on so I won't belabor this. Nonetheless, I do want to state explicitly that the tendency to view rapping as a naturalized harvest of blackness belies the fact that the art form does require work. Here, Rakim engages this notion by naming the studio, the site where a rapper works, and by connecting money-making to the test of commercial viability. Put simply, Paid in Full is not a narrative of already achieved success. Rather, it is a tale of pregnant possibility. In making the speaker an autobiographical projection of Rakim, we as listeners make the act of going into the booth a mere formality. After all, the already in late 1980s legendary rapper could not have endured any insecurities about his ability to make a living as an MC. He is, by the time listeners hear the album, a sure bet. Rakim frustrates interpretations that assume a triumph of virtuosity by ringing his depiction with the language of external judgment. In basic terms, he casts the economic viability of his raps as referendums voted upon by others. Rakim crowns his track with this development, but Outkast, in our second stop on this sojourn, makes these negotiations the entire substance of their suspirations. Vexing attainment. In 2004, the Atlanta-based duo Outkast became the first rap act to win a Grammy for the Best Album of the Year. That transcendent moment ensured their position in musical lore, yet a scant 8 years earlier on their sophomore effort, AT Aliens, they offered the single Elevators, a cut that bore no traces of comfortable coronation. The song's central conceit involves its eponymous image, that of the elevator. Written 3 years before Colson Whitehead's The Intuitionist immortalized the conveyance in black cultural experience, Outkast Diddy tells the story of the group's movement from Headland and DeLow, an Atlanta intersection where they spit a freestyle that earned them studio time, to a hit debut record, Southern Playalistic Cadillac Funky Music. Rakim left us on the cusp of the studio, wondering whether the capitalistic marketplace would allow him to turn his pull into suitable payment. Picking up his thread a decade later, Outkast muses in this fashion. This verse, written by Andre Benjamin, aka Andre 3000, hinges on the search for the proverbial hookup, a phrase oft associated with a favor achieved through a connection or knowing someone. If Rakim presented the commercial prospect in rap as a collision between individual talent and vague free market realities, then Outkast fleshes out this process by picturing mic skills that must move from private to public spaces. The rooms in which Andre watches ceiling fans go round are not the same as the hole-in-the-wall clubs where he and his partner must perform. By the same token, taking the 86 MARTA bus to Lithonia is not the same thing as riding the 5-series Beamer that West Coast rapper Roscos mentions in his 1996 cut, Anything Goes. The distance from home to the club and buses to luxury autos represent the space between wanting and getting money. Where Rakim acknowledges that robbery and a 9-to-5 could fill that gap, by the mid-1990s, Outkast represents rap as a viable, if convoluted, route to economic success. Their perspective on that convolution echoes in the final stop in our exploration. No life better than yours. The final verse of Elevators includes an exchange between Andre 3000 and a speaker who claims that he went to school with him. While Three has no memory of this supposed classmate, he pauses long enough to hear him say, "What kind of car you drive? I know y'all paid. I know y'all got boohoo cool with hoes from all them songs that y'all done made." His response ends with this observation. "I've got more fans than the average man, but not enough loot to last me. To the end of the week, I live by the beat like you live check to check. If you don't move your feet, then I don't eat, so we like neck and neck." This response gently lampoons the outside fantasies of wealth that fans project onto rappers, and it evocatively equates the performer with his audience. In the 2014 cut, Love Yours, Fayetteville, North Carolina born, New York based lyricist J. Cole returns to this terrain. Cole signed to Jay-Z's Rockefeller Records amid great fanfare. In 2011, he released his first album, Cole World. He followed that with 2013's Born Sinner. While both of these records portrayed a range of emotional experiences, Love Yours ruminates on the problems that come with money. Specifically, Cole contends that relationships might be easier without the distractions of affluence. He explains. Although his skepticism about cash connects with earlier works like Puff Daddy's 1997 single, Mo' Money, Mo' Problems, Cole employs a tone of lament that pushes his track into the register occupied by T.I.'s 2012 hit, Sorry. The money message here is cautionary, evoking listeners who see him on TV and lust after his Rolexes, cars, cribs, and women. Cole disarmingly avers that being broke was better than what he experiences now. His remark not only contravenes the stereotype of the rapper, but also invites aggressive interpretation. On an album where he states, "She deserved that. She a bird. This a bird trap. You think if I didn't rap, she would flirt back?" His declaration that he would rather be broke acquires fascinating significance. I won't prolong the time by teasing out the implications here. Nonetheless, Cole's juxtaposition of regret and exploitation begs the question of why he simultaneously finds money instrumental and inhibiting. It grants him sexual conquest even as it arrests emotional connections. I want to end by pursuing a few macro-level comments, and then I will invite my partner into the conversation. Unwanted citizens. So you might ask, why all this furor regarding 18 to 30-year-old black men and their discussion of ends, loot, Skrilla cream, green flow, or dough? As I leave, I want to hazard a few thoughts. In the context of discourses asserting black males' ethical bankruptcy, I think that it is important to shine a scholarly light on how and where they debate morality. This exercise not only exposes hitherto hidden conversations regarding cultural values, but also suggests that civic engagements might be more nuanced than has been acknowledged. Melissa Harris Perry, among others, has researched black male spheres like barbershops as sites of political negotiation. If her focus is on black exchanges, then Catherine Kramer, in work dating back to 2004, argues that unexpected informal venues actually shape communal consciousness and political behavior in far-reaching ways. For instance, in her upcoming book, The Politics of Resentment, Rural Consciousness in Wisconsin and the Rise of Scott Walker, she contends that oft-ignored rural mindsets laid the foundation for a gubernatorial coup that few had anticipated. What does this heartland development mean for our glimpse into rap's engagement with money? Here's a little story that must be told. Jay-Z, in a 2004 conversation with Bakari Kitwana, asserted that his wealth marked the browning of America, the arrival of a more equal playing field. When Kitwana asked about the significance of this development, Mr. Beyonce stated, "At the end of the day, I just want to have something to leave for my kids and the next generation of kids. Growing up, I knew no one, zero people, whose family left them a business, something they could look forward to, aspire to. That's hope." Jay-Z's contention brings us full circle back to Noah Smith's linkage of rap narratives to Horatio Alger. If Jay-Z views the American dream as attainable, then as we have seen, he, along with other rappers, see their art form as an avenue towards fuller participation in such economic opportunities. The rosy outlook implicit in this formulation does not square with the vehement impugning of rap that arises from so many quarters. Put differently, while jealousy could be one part of rap haters' motivation, it is difficult to believe that Bill O'Reilly, Farrakhan, and C. Dolores Tucker were critiquing rappers because they wanted to leave a firm economic foundation for their families. No, the narratives surrounding money here are complicated, and the real controversy regarding rap music and loot centers on the contestation over the appropriate places for civic discourse. O'Reilly, Farrakhan, and Tucker aren't just railing against rappers because they show more skin, spew more curses, and fold more scratch. They are lamenting the loss of control over civic dialogue. When the public square no longer sits proximate to your neighborhood, the balance of power risks teetering in unexpected ways. The money matters mulled over in rap music may not have been the cause of recent unrest in Missouri and elsewhere. However, this soundtrack heralds new contemplations of black participation in civic action. More precisely, rap's paradoxical perceptions of mammon signal the ethical energy that a post-9/11 generation will exert as it learns how to lead. Just as Cornell Brooks's assumption of the NAACP presidency marks a reckoning, the rise of young folks whose notions of success will be concomitantly bourgeois and communal means that settled verities will soon be examined and refined. The scrupulous scholar of rap will have a head start when the analysis of these adjustments begin. Thank you.
We're going to talk for a little bit. Thank you so much, Michael. So I'm here more to play kind of the side role. He's going to be Chuck D and the Bomb Squad. I might get to play beat. I might serve as apprentice to Terminator. We'll see. There's so much to talk here, and I'm sure you guys have lots of questions, lots of points to make yourselves. I just want to go over a few of the things that you brought up in your wonderful presentation, Michael. The first being, man, where do you start? But the first being the conservative front, if we're going to say that's represented by Bill and Fox News. What is their inherent fear of the discussions happening in rap songs? Is it because there are so many young white dollars also involved in rap? If it was just in the black community, would it even blip on their radar? What are your thoughts on that?
Exactly. I mean, I think that the recent NWA movie made it clear, and the phenomenon of NWA is so potent in this regard, is that once suburban listeners, white listeners between the ages of 16 and 30 start ingesting this music, then you're looking at the potential for a cultural transformation. Every generation in America, every mainstream generation in America goes through a rebellion. But when the time comes to step up to lead, right? So if you think of the 1960s and you think of the liberalism associated in the 1960s, the Summer of Love, when the time comes to lead, then this generation moves from its most liberal frameworks and moves more conservatively towards a centrist position to prepare themselves to lead. What we were contemplating in the 1990s is a moment where a message that originates in spaces utterly foreign to the socialization of these children became the soundtrack of their life. And the elders had the same alarmist reaction that prior generations had, but they genuinely feared that when it came time to govern, that this centrist push would not occur, right? Like that these children, that their sons and daughters would stay further on this fringe and not make the move to the center that bourgeois entitlement generally carries along with it. And I think that rap uniquely evoked these kinds of fears because you have to understand there are prior moments in Black musical experience that carry these kinds of energies, but the post-civil rights reality, this post Martin Luther King's assassination in 68, and the fact that rap music is one of the first Black popular musics to arise in the aftermath of the civil rights era, I think generates a different kind of crucible in the cultural imagination. People are thinking that this might be different. This might be different than the blues. This might be different than jazz. This might be a different moment because the racial politics of the society are decidedly different. They are legislatively different.
And where do we stand now? Do we find that there has been a change in the way that people react, or does the same sort of traditions carry forth with the youth becoming more conservative as they become older, as they become leaders in our society, as they start to make political decisions, start to make economic decisions going forward?
I mean, I think that if the Oklahoma frat boys are any indication, then, you know, yeah. I mean, and I think this is what's happening as you look at J. Cole, as you look at Kendrick Lamar and the laments, right, the turn towards a cultural insularity. In the early portions of the 21st century, the bling and the narrative of cultural assimilation prevailed within rap. Many people felt genuinely. Dr. Dre famously said in the documentary The Show in 1994, it's all entertainment. What ended the East-West beef was not reconciliation between rappers. Money ended the East-West beef. They were like, let's go all make some money. You know, let's go all get rich and stop killing each other and make as much money. But part of what J. Cole, part of what Kendrick, you know, part of what T.I., part of what Andre 3000 on the devastating verse. I mean, if you don't listen to any other rap verse in your life, listen to Andre's verse on T.I.'s his verse, where he talks about the ambivalence that he has toward wealth, the ambivalence that he has toward the lifestyle that he's been afforded at this moment. And I think that it connects directly to what you're talking about because they felt that it would be a more utopian opportunity. They felt that racial cooperation and the pluralistic audiences that they confronted all over the world with regard to hip hop will ultimately produce a more optimistic future. But I think that as they look across the landscape and see the realities of what they're confronting, you know, in terms of law enforcement situations in the contemporary moment, in terms of systemic inequality, I mean, you know, even Big J had to back up from the Barney's piece when people were like, yo, man, how can you be, you can't spend your way out of institutional poverty. You can't spin your way out of the consequences of institutional racism.
What do we make of Kanye's latest moves, his insistence to become, you know, a fashion demigod, to show another example of how you can break into business as an independent, you know, entrepreneur? Is that something that we should regard with pride, something we should take as a cautionary tale? How do we view that in the current landscape?
Kanye is an interesting cat because his moves look conventional to the untrained eye. If you looked at him through the lens of in an untutored way, he just looks like he's trying to make money. What's fascinating about Kanye is he probably has an educational trajectory that is closer to Public Enemy than any group or any artist that has come through since then, right? Like his subversive potential is immense. Now, I don't know if he's ever going to activate that. You know, like, I keep waiting for his Wonder Twin powers to activate and for him to fully be, you know, like, this subversive, you know, figure that he certainly has the possibility to be. But at times, he just sounds like a narcissist. And this is the problem, is that all of these narratives of a return, right? Like all of these narratives of reluctant wealth in between sleeping with everybody they can possibly sleep with because of their fame, the reluctance that emerges. Drake's Marvin's Room is the great narrative of lament. You know, my life is, you know, my fame is too much. It's frustrating me that I can't really have genuine emotional relationships with these women I'm seeking to exploit, but. You know, that's the way it goes down, right? And that ambivalence, that paradox is a sight of possibility until it's not. I mean, like when you're 45, then I have to wonder, are you ever going to move beyond productive dissonance? You know, like, you know, when you're 17, I call that possibility. And when you get to be like 45, I'll be like, yo, that's just who you are. You know, like, there's no evolution in sight. You know, like, you just about to be that person. So I think with Kanye, you know, I don't know what universe. I mean, when you go into the Cardassian universe, that's another world, man.
When you watch... You mentioned T.I. When you watch a rapper like that who has an experience, has been to prison, or if you take someone like Wayne, not just they went to prison before they were rappers, but have been incarcerated during the course of their career, have returned and back our record labels, back putting out music. What kind of trends are you seeing? How are the lyrics changing? How is the content of what they're putting out there shifting?
I mean, T.I. and Wayne, again, these are... There's a rapper out of Chicago, Ryan Fest, and Ryan Fest doesn't have like a very high view of Southern rap in general, but he makes a point to suggest that, oh, you know, T.I. can rap. You know, he's possessed of talent. And part of the challenge with T is that when Tip goes out, he has to decide whether or not he wants to make money or whether or not he wants to make statements. And this is the difficulty, right? Is that because Andre comes on his album, and this is the thing, we talk about Sorry, Andre comes on his album and basically just destroys the concept of postures of apology, right? The song is called Sorry, right? Like, it's meant to be a tropological exploration of things that you didn't feel good that you did. And Tip is like cosmetically engaging these elements. And then Drake comes in and he's like, cut it out. Right? Like, cut it out. And this is the thing, is that you need elders. And this is one thing that's happened within the world of rap, is like, you need elders to push you. In every musical tradition, you need an elder to push you. You need a virtuosic elder who has stature to say, quit counterfeiting. Now, quit playing around. And we're starting to see these kinds of intergenerational dialogues in rap. I mean, J. Cole puts out Let Nas Down because he thinks that he has capitulated far too often to commercial inducements as he's seeking to construct an artistic self. And I think that going to prison, right, produces some priorities every time you come out, right? I mean, the experience of going to prison, you know, to the extent that visiting prison often over the course of my uncle's incarceration, you know, seeing this dude locked up and seeing the consequences, you know, of a 25-year bid, you know, registered in somebody's face, I'm assuming that they grapple, you know, like it produces of moral reckoning. And that's really all I'm trying to say is that, I mean, I'm not trying to make a grand apology. I laugh at people who try to excoriate rap. I said, well, you don't know enough rap to excoriate it well. I said, if you truly trying to find the stuff to excoriate, then come over and I'll give you, you like the stuff you really need in order to excoriate rap. Most people, because I you don't really like the music. And if you don't like the music, you don't know the nastiest stuff that's in rap. I was like, that's in a one stack in my room from when I was 17. I was like, oh, okay, this is the nastiest rap ever invented, right? So you can do that, but what's fascinating to me is the Walt Whitman dimensions of paradox that exists within rap. You know, how people are capable of the most heinous expressions on the one hand, and they with no compulsion, right? Like, it's not as if somebody comes along and says, hey, you know, you gotta make a positive song. Nah, man, you know, like, there's nobody there saying to you, oh, you need to change your tune. They're capable of literally beating someone to death in the narrative on one track, and then in the next track of talking about their relationship with their mother or their relationship with someone who they sought to provide opportunities for that they couldn't have. And I think that this is what you see with T.I. and what you see with Wayne, not just intracommunally, right? I mean, T.I. is responsible for Iggy Azalea's career in many ways, right? Like, he introduces her. He brings her out. And even in contemporary terms, as people are turning on her, as black artists are turning on her and saying, you don't know this, his Q-Tip saying, yo, you don't understand X, Y, and Z, T.I. is still like, look, you know, I ride with people. If I ride with you, then I ride with you. We fell out, yeah, but I'm still willing to support you and to try to make something happen in your career. And I think these are the kinds of personality dynamics, right? Like, a lot of times people look at Wayne and they're like, you know, the zaniest behavior that's possible, right? Like, he's capable of the zaniest behavior that you can imagine. But by the same token, he has donated over $600,000 to the rebuilding of post-Katrina New Orleans. And it wasn't because he could make money out of it. Luke Skywalker, the creator of pornographic rap, has donated more money to South Beach and to communities in need in Florida than perhaps any other entertainer down there. And there's never a camera to take a picture of him while he's doing it. There's never anybody around. So I think these are the kinds of protean personalities that we're dealing with, people who are capable and willing and in all likelihood will dazzle you with their capacity to misbehave. But for some reason, they're possessed of moral entanglement. That's what I mean by this notion of ethical striving that is going on in their characters. And my man Joe is over there. He knows that in the Christian tradition, that ethical striving exists for a lot of people. that ain't something that's, you know, like, David wasn't no perfect person.
You talked about the positive tracks that come out. You know, you might have an album with 11 cuts of just hardcore life, and then one track that, you know, is about your family, you know, just to make sure you got a shout out in there. Do you see a difference, you know, in the artistic posturing that comes between those tracks? You know, sometimes you might even see a Tupac, you might see Rakim come in and take on a more personal essayistic tone to that song, whereas the other songs are really in that fictional world of I am creating a character. Even if I am the main character, it is a different person than the narrator who's the person, you know, who wrote the album is the individual, the rapper himself.
Yeah, I mean, different rappers, I think, are very careful about dramatizing persona. We talk in class a lot of times when we're talking about hip hop. We talk in class about narrative decisions, You know, like how it is that a rapper decides to dramatize a first-person narrator. Some of the worst hip-hop criticism assumes autobiographical content in every hip-hop song. Right? Every hip-hop song is literally a first-person narrative that is about the person who made the song. Right? So Mind of a Madman, I am the madman. No, like any right? Like there is no Blind Jackson, legendary critic of African-American literature, talked about when he went to grad school and he told his dissertation advisor, he said, I would like to write a dissertation on irony in African-American literature. His dissertation advisor said, there's no such thing. And this is the way we treat rap, like as if they're incapable, as if these people are incapable of wielding the figurative tools that is that are connected to expression in language that we've seen over and over again. And I think coming back to the point that you're making is that different rappers have different notions, and the best rappers, right? Because this is the other thing is like, you know, when we go into class, I said, rap is no different from any other art form. Mediocrity prevails in the vast majority of art forms. Like if you looked at 100% of the art of classical music, right? Like it's just like, oh, the revered world of classical music. That's like, you just ain't heard the bad stuff. Right? You'd be like, yo, it take a lot in order to get performed. And at the end of the day, they'd be like, if you bad, they'd just be like, you gotta be bad at home. You ain't gonna be bad in public, right? And I think that a lot of rap is bad, but the best rappers really dramatized this, right? Like Common came of age, right? Like Common, when he first came out, he was he was like the poet Alexander Pope. He was a wit. Everything for him was double entendre. Everything was him for him was, I've been sleeping with the thesaurus and I'm going to get you with my enjambment, right? Like I'm gonna you know, like impress you in certain ways with my in rhyme and it will dazzle you. But rappers have to master the art of narrative. You have to get to narrative, right? Like, because you can only dazzle with pyrotechnics, right? Keith Murray was a rapper who came out in the 1990s, and, you know, Keith Murray was the first rapper to use the word sesquipedalian in a rap. And people were like, yo, Keith Murray's gonna take rap by storm. I listened to Keith Murray's albums, I was like, he got no stories. No, he's got no grounding. There is no sense of detail. There is no sense of nuance. There is no sense of attention to situation. He's trying to overwhelm me, you know, with his erudition. And rap ain't the SAT, man. You know, that's not what this is about. And I think it comes back is that part of what rappers understood. I mean, one of the simplest conceits in all of rap, Slick Rick's children's story, the most basic notion, right? Coupled with Run DMC's Peter Piper, right? The notion of the Pied Piper of Hamelin, a person who's capable of pulling you by your nose out of your chair with tunes. Run DMC said, well, I got the idea for that song because I was reading nursery rhymes to my daughter. Right, just sitting around in between tour dates, and I was reading nursery rhymes to her. And I think this is the piece, right? Like, is that people discover these narrative repositories. They discover spaces to position themselves, and they're capable of being profound in those moments. That's where their profundity arises, and that's where those real sites of moral negotiation are taking place, is because Andre's partner said, you don't never want to tell nobody that you helped your sister get through college, right? Rappers, they never wanted to let anybody know that they helped their aunt make their mortgage payments for like the past 12 years. They're scared to reveal these details, and narrative allows them to smuggle some things in, right? Some things that they wouldn't do in a direct autobiographical way, they can smuggle in some things, some laments, some questions.
So what you just did, you know, you looked back, you're almost archiving the history of hip-hop as we have it, and we did it in a very intellectual setting here at the Iowa City Public Library. you know, esteemed professor from the University of Iowa. I know we got probably 70% students in this crowd. How do we carry that conversation into a more mainstream form? How do we get that message out? Rap has been around long enough that there are instructive tales to be told by what's happened in the last 30 years. How do we get that information out? Is that the job of rappers themselves, or does that fall beyond, you know, beyond their world? And what is my responsibility? What do we do as listeners, and now as we get older, as the teachers of the next generation, not just in the classroom but through life?
Yeah. I mean, this is my dig. This is my gig, man. You know, I started off as a fan, and I tell my students all the time, y'all sorry fans. Y'all don't even listen to the music well enough as fans. And anytime I get a rap album, I get a rap cassette, it was done. Till I knew it. Till I knew the whole album, like the entire album. Coming to your point, the rappers never will. You know, in jazz, my buddy Damani's back there. Hopefully he'll back me up on this. You know, Son Ra is a bad dude, but his explanations of his art, you know, his attempts to explain what it is that he's up to, don't circulate well. They don't travel well in the mainstream. And in some ways, personally, I just had to come up off the bench. You know, I refused to write about rap music. I stopped going to conferences where they were talking about rap music. I sort of willfully withdrew from that world. You know, I was around with a lot of people. My boy Adam Bradley, who's written Book of Rhymes, checked it out. Imani Perry, who's written Prophets of the Hood. I went to school with these people, and, you know, we were on panels at first, but I was like, man, you know, this is ridiculous. Because the alchemy of the art form was ultimately being overdetermined by, you know, professional considerations. And I knew why they had to do it. You know, they trying to get tenure. You know, they trying to secure their positions within the university. And I appreciate it. But at the end of the day, I was like, man, you know, I don't know that that's what I want to do. I don't know that that's the way that I want to be involved in it. But with the digital world now, you know, with the digital humanities out there, I think there's a way to do this criticism. There's a way to display this culture, to curate this culture. And you also are having decision makers who now have saturated arts regimes. So it's no longer a situation where Fab Five Freddy is standing on the outside of an art gallery and saying, you know, graffiti is really interesting. You should put it up.
Right.
It's a much more organic interrelationship, and I think we're getting to the point now where radio is no longer the primary curatorial framework, right? Like, so whereas radio before, people would be like, yo, I gotta get radio play, or I gotta somehow do it. There are now things like Witching Hour, there are spaces, you know, like there are festivals, there are music spheres where we can begin to imagine, you know, innovative presentations of the music. So that it's no longer the same. Because I think that, you know, when Chuck and the Public Enemy came out here and the Bomb Squad came out here, he was in an old man mode. And he was like, man, you know, I'm 50-something years old. You know, I'm going to be touring. Talk about fight the power that be. He said, it's only so many more years that I'm gonna be able to do, right? You know, I mean, right. He was like, he was still enjoying it. You know, they had, you know, like a revitalizing single, but he was like, man, I ain't trying to be out here, you know, like 100 years old, talking about, hey. So trying to find and trying to support innovative curations of the culture. You know, like that's my whole focus now, is trying to partner with some people and trying to educate a generation of people to think of rap as a cultural repository, to really see it as a space that contains a culture's values, as opposed to just seeing it as, you know, a peripheral commercial product.
Right, and I think it will take a collaboration between, say, the academic world, the community, the other folks moving throughout their different daily actions. Like, it's not one, one pyramid, yeah. one building cannot distill the message for everyone. It's gonna be a collaboration. I mean, what maybe we haven't found or maybe is developing right now is if you grew up in the 90s and you were a rock and roll person, you always had that record store mm-hmm. where you had mm-hmm. that person at the record store, the mm-hmm. seller, yeah. selling you yeah. the new Sonic Youth record or whatever yeah. it was at the time. Yeah. And how do we create that own world, our own world for that, for rap,
yeah.
so that people have the new thing, which they're probably going to hear about, but also know the history of where it came from.
Oh, yeah.
You know, I think it's going to take some effort.
Oh, yeah. There's no question.
I'll just ask one more question because I know you guys got questions and comments you want to get at. You know, you're talking about Paid in Full, and I know you can only take out small clips, but that track is even more instructive than you might have let on to be at the beginning of the record. If I'm not mistaken, Eric B gets on and lists the manager's name, the agent's name, the record label's name. Like, this is how you build a rap career.
Right.
Can you build a team and then maybe you can do this?
Yeah.
And even taking it to, you know, Outkast. On the verse that you had that Andre's on, where he's talking to the, you know, the old person he may or may not know, and I mean him saying, you know, I'm doing this day in, day out. I live by the beat. You know, it's like you check to check.
Yep.
I mean, there's almost like a socialist, or like even communist, like under a manifesto underneath. Yep. You know, the way that he's putting it out there, and I just wonder how we can get those messages out, just so people can, how we can put a bigger light on the ways in which some artists, some rappers, some producers are saying this is a way that you can live this American life. Because often the juxtaposition is, if I'm not making the beat, then I'm selling drugs or I'm doing something else illicit. And that's not to say that rappers have just illicit things in our minds, but it's just those are the opportunities provided in America.
Yeah.
Like if you come from a certain class position, that, you know, maybe it is easier to do that, to be involved in drugs or to be involved in selling drugs. And so how do we get those messages out that there are alternate paths? Because a lot of rappers are saying it, and some of them are very popular, but some of them are just still day-to-day, still doing it, but don't stop.
Yeah. I mean, to me, the Roots are a perfect example of what you're talking about. The Roots have, in addition to Jimmy Fallon, you're talking about 80 gigs a year to keep a performing band together, right? Somebody's like, yo, you know, it's five or six people. You understand the economics mm-hmm. of this. Somebody be like, yo, we all gotta eat. And if everybody in the band ain't eating, then the band is in danger of falling right. apart, right? Like if it's one or two people, we'd be like, yo, man, you know, when's the next gig gonna be? And you'd be like, well, 6 months from now. And be like, yo, I'm gonna be dead. And all my bills are gonna be due, and my daughter is gonna be living outside, you know. So I think that critical listening is important. Rap is a veritable smorgasbord, right? You can find rap that engages any topic that you're interested in. My dissertation advisor, Larry Buell, called me up when he was working on his environmental criticism book or eco-criticism book. He's in the process of putting together a treatment of Emerson and Thoreau. He said, well, are there any environmental rappers, you know, that I could put in? I was like, yeah, you know, it's people who is environmental rappers, you know, it's rappers who are concerned about the environment, so I could turn them on. So I think that we have to let go of bifurcated mindsets. Jay-Z is talking to Talib Kweli in this cut moment of clarity. And he said, if consciousness soul, lyrically, I'd be Talib Kweli. Because in Jay's mind, rightly or wrongly, fulfillment of his destiny hinges on making more money than any rapper has ever made in history. And he's done it. You may say, oh, you know, that's an unworthy goal. He said, that's what I wanted to do. right? That is that is what I set out to do. But for every Jay-Z who set out to make as much money as he possibly can, there are other rappers who have set different agendas for themselves. For every Ice Cube who's decided to take the path that he's taken, there's his cousin Dell the Funky Homo Sapien, who's decided to make music of a different sort, you know, along with Freestyle Fellowship and that whole collective that's coming along out there. So you gotta love the culture enough to dig around. And you gotta also call people out when they say stupid stuff. You know, and that's the other part, you know, I guess of me coming off the bench is maybe calling people out when they say stupid stuff.
Take cover. we're gonna open this up for comments and questions from this audience. Just gonna get the mic turned on here for in one moment. But just be sure to use the mic there because they're recording this and they wanna make sure they capture all the content. Are there any questions or comments from the audience? Go for it. Don't be shy. Yeah, we need to get into the mic.
Early October, I went out to Philadelphia. That's the city where the Pope had visited, and there was quite a to-do about that, but I got there right after he was there, and I found a newspaper called The Calling, and I had never read The Calling before, but I brought it home with me and read it quite a bit because it's Louis Farrakhan's newspaper. So I felt like Louis Farrakhan made a lot of sense, frankly, and I'm not real familiar with Farrakhan, but I felt like his message was very integrative with the Christian and the Jewish and, you know, the religions of today. So I also then looked at a particular rapper, and I think it was Kanye. I think that's who it was. And his message was really right on. So I became very interested in this and thought, wow, we've really got to encourage this more, you know, right here in Iowa City where we have racial problems. And so I gave it all to a friend who happens to be black, and he threw it away. He said, this is just propaganda. It makes no sense at all. It has no meaning to him. And I'm so disappointed because I really thought we were getting somewhere. And then right here at home, when I come back, someone who should know, he said, no, this is not where it's at. I don't know where it is at for him, but it's not that. Right. So could you fill me in a little more on the cultural implication of Louis Farrakhan? And Farrakhan was advertising this Million Man March in Washington, D.C. It was coming up October 10th. They had it. I don't think it was terribly well publicized, but they did do it. And I don't know if that's a valid part of the rap movement now or not. I just would like you to comment on that, both of you, if you can.
Before there's a comment, just put a little more pressure on that. Which of Farrakhan's and Kanye's messages resonated most deeply with you?
Well, Louis Farrakhan was comparing the Christian beliefs of the second coming of Christ and the Muslim beliefs of the prevailing of the Muhammad, and also the Judaism that is involved in that. In other words, these three three monotheistic religions, he was putting them all together in one nice package in an article talking about those three. And I felt that being a Christian and someone who really looks closely at these issues, I thought it all seemed very positive And then Kanye, if that's the right man, I just picked him up on the internet as someone who was rapping, and he just sounded so good. I wish I had it. Everyone could see. I'm disappointed you didn't show us more of the good stuff, because that's what I was hoping for. Anything else?
No, thank you.
I mean, part of what you run into with Farrakhan and rap is that at base, the Nation of Islam is a conservative organization, very steeped in tropes that are not unfamiliar with Victorian society. I mean, these notions of patriarchal frameworks, these notions of female submission, and even the ideas of the work ethic that sit at the center of the self-made individual, the ethos of the self-made individual. It is a mindset that quietly could endorse the outcomes of the civil rights movement, even as it never would endorse the techniques of the civil rights movement. Right? Like the outcomes, the assimilationist, the integrationist frameworks, they were like, we want maximized opportunity, but we don't need racial commingling in order to do it. What I would suggest with regard to hip hop culture is that the vogue that Farrakhan and his nationalist orientation enjoy in hip hop in the 1990s rapidly recedes. You know, like by the time you get to the 21st century, rappers are no longer, I mean, like Public Enemy used to be like a follower of Farrakhan. Don't tell me that you understand unless you know the man. Ain't nobody rapping that no more. Outside of the Nation of Islam. You know, like Nation of Islam rappers might be rapping that, but you know, you ain't gonna hear Kendrick run around talking about, you know, oh, you know, follow a Farrakhan. You know, nah, you know, he might go to a march or hear something every now and then. And I think that is a point, and perhaps one that, you know, as I try to bring this out in a written piece, perhaps too subtle here, is that there's an intergenerational tension between C. Dolores Tucker, between Calvin Butts, between Farrakhan, you know, between black civil rights leaders, between leaders who occupy a prominent position in earlier moments, and the hip hop generation. The tension was there as early as the 1980s. We talked about it in class. Chris may remember this is, Farrakhan and Malcolm X are sampled more on Public Enemy's album than Martin Luther King and Jesse Jackson. Farrakhan and Malcolm X are sampled 20, 25 times on this album. Jesse Jackson and Martin Luther King are sampled like once. In the case of Jesse Jackson, zero. In the case of MLK. Public Enemy is too smart, they're too purposeful, they're too intentional for that to have been coincidence, right? This is an ideological decision that they made and that, you know, they ultimately wanted to be associated with. And I think that, you know, when you talk about Kanye has every opportunity to endorse Farrakhan. He's from Chicago, they're from the same spot. You know, he grows up in the shadow of the Nation of Islam. If that's what he wanted to do, then he could have done it in unqualified terms. But I think that he ultimately sees Farrakhan as emblematic of a particular mindset that doesn't fit with the brand of capitalistic conquest that he has in mind, right? Like the insular ideas that Farrakhan operates according to, the kinds of audiences that he wants to cultivate, the way that he sees economic growth taking place. Kanye, part of the reason why he goes to the fashion industry is because for him, that is a transnational capitalistic model, right? Like it's global, right? Money. And he sees that as attractive. You know, it's a curiosity for him. I mean, I really think that, you know, he plays around with these things like volleyballs in his head, and he's like, oh, you know, might be interesting. You know, let's see.
And even further for Kanye, he probably has nothing to gain by with an associate in affair. You know, nothing against, but certainly nothing to gain.
Yeah, his narcissism would not allow him to admit of a fair kind.
Thank you for the question.
Yeah, appreciate it. Go ahead.
Well, I hate to make it the Kanye Q&A, but I just had one quick question about that. It wasn't my initial question, but what do you make of his level of seriousness from the MTV Music Awards speech about transitioning into a political life? Yeah. And how does the element of anger and anti-establishmentarian politics that we're seeing now play either to that opportunity, either positively or negatively, in the next cycle?
Yeah.
Thank you.
I mean, the thing is that if Donald Trump makes his way in the way, you know, like this is what Kanye sees. I'm just trying to sit in his head for a minute. If he sees reality television, if he sees shock jock politics, you know, producing results, you know, a genuine opportunity, an end run around all establishment politics, right? Like, because every time I see Kanye West doing something, I just immediately think of Bobby Rush. Right? Like, I immediately think of Harold Washington. I'm like, you know, like, how hard was it for them to claim any credibility as political speakers, right? Like Carol Moseley Braun, like in that environment, in Chicago in particular. You know, like, you got to know what kind of political town Chicago is in order to understand this, right? Like, and it's hard won. And you looking at people, you know, this is part of what leads Jesse Jackson to say what he says about Obama. He's like, dude, you know how long it took me to get this mic? I'm never giving this microphone away, ever. I'm going to be dead. Microphone going to be in my hand. So people who are capable of commanding the mic, you know, who are capable of getting these platforms, you know, by skipping steps, you know, like just and seemingly glibly declaring themselves capable of doing things. And like I say, you know, I mean, looking at Bobby Rush, and I know Bobby Rush be like, boy, he just want to smack him, right? Because he's like, oh, you know, you know what kind of coalition building I had to engage in? You know what kind of listening sessions I had to endure? You know what kind of patient coalition building I had to deal with in order to do this? But to speak to your question, he might run, you know, if the right set of possibilities coalesced. The interesting thing, though, is that, and this comes back to something Andre was talking about earlier, I mean, you have hip-hop politicians now, right? Like, you have politicians, right, by hip-hop, I don't mean that they were rappers and then they became politicians. You have politicians who articulate similar messages as those that Kanye would, if to the extent that it would ever be coherent, because this is the other thing, is that, you know, you got to stop long enough to actually come up with a platform. And you know, that brother, yeah, you know, depends, yeah. You know, you could just run on the basis of being married to Kim and be like, yeah, how many people gonna vote for me on that?
Yeah, and I mean, I think Kanye has really strong opinions and has big ideas, but ultimately is probably not anti-establishment. Mm-hmm. You know, when it comes down to it, I think he wants to succeed greatly within the system, whether it's politically or just, you know, on an entertainment level, on a fashion level. Yeah. In terms of the growing discontent in our country, it might sound weird to say, but I think you'd find more akin to someone in the Tea Party and someone like Kendrick Lamar, maybe on different sides, but are expressing this attitude of, I just give up with the system that we have. Yeah. And so maybe we need to reconsider different ways to live through the system or to be entirely apathetic to it. And so that will be interesting to see how that develops over the next 4 years, over the next 8 years. And to even track how rappers, how the discussion changes through music. As you know, you have rappers who continue to live within that system, and others who are, you know, showing a more, you know, a less working America, a less successful America. Thanks.
I wanted to ask a question, or at least I wanted to get your comment on kind of the conflict between authenticity and entertainment. One of the big issues for me is this whole idea that rappers have when you talk about materialism and homophobia and the way women are disrespected, and they want to say, oh yeah, we're authentic and this is who we are and this is what we believe. And then when somebody calls them on it, they say, well, it's just entertainment. And I really have problems with that, and I don't know how to, I don't know how to fix it, but I think it's problematic, and I think there's something that should be dealt with. So I just wanted you guys' comments on that.
I don't know if we have time to fully. That might be a different conversation. but it is an important question indeed. No answers on that, except I think authenticity in rap is shifting, where if you're presenting a certain cast of characters or a certain lifestyle, it was expected maybe for a long time that you would have also been a part of that. I think with the amount of success that has been had on different levels by different sorts of rappers, so if you have that Beyonce, Jay-Z level of just ultimate American success, it doesn't matter. They're not locked into having to be from the streets, even though Jay-Z's history as, you know, being minorly or moderately involved in the drug game at some point, that's just irrelevant now. And no one will call into question his abilities to be a producer or a rapper except on the basis of whether that track is good or whether that track is not good. And so I think he's reached that level, which is a certain amount of success, and not to bring it back to Kanye, but I think he's done a lot of work for just saying, I'm going to be my crazy self, you know, and whatever my ideas are, I'm going to put them out there. And it's not about being authentic to what you believe a rapper needs to be. It's just being authentic to the beats that I put down and the rhymes that come out. And so I think there's a lot less pressure unless you come out of the box, which is more, I think, now entertainment rap. You know, if you're Rick Ross or, you know, and then you might get called out. But for the ones who are trying to see this, I think, as a lucrative but artistic endeavor, they're kind of just sticking to their guns of what they know and whatever their aesthetic is. And I don't think they got the, I don't think they have that authenticity pressure that might have existed in 1989, 1990, in the era of, you know, say Ice Cube or N.W.A.
Yeah. I mean, the other thing that's happened is the music has changed. The music distribution model has changed. Like Hollywood, rap is very much driven by imitation. Record companies are looking, and in the heyday of the album, you know, from the mid-1980s probably through to the end of 2000, this was the height of imitation is the highest form of flattery. So if N.W.A. comes out and is talking about B's and H's, then every rapper who's aspiring to get through the door at priority is like, yo, I got to get that in my line. And I think this speaks to what Andre was talking about, is that when you had a model that was driven, right, like, because much attention is paid, there are these certain, you know, my other thing is hip-hop pedagogy, you know, trying to be responsible with regard to teaching this as an academic subject. And it's so many moving parts. And the sound scan situation is often called into question. Before the mid-1980s, they never knew how much rap was being sold because point-of-sale transactions could not be scanned electronically. Most rap was sold in mom-and-pop situations, and they were just guessing. So Sylvia Roan over at Sugar Hill, she might be like, oh, we know how many units we're shipping. You know, like, so when Rapper's Delight comes out, and she was like, yo, we're shipping 400,000 units a week, right? She didn't care how many of them were being sold. She was just like, yo, we shipping 400,000 copies of a album that I didn't think was going to make any money a week, and it's making lots of money. But when sound scan comes in, then the capacity to create models, right? Like to create models that people have to follow. And I think, you know, accelerating to the 21st century, Maybach music, Wale is an excellent example. Wale comes out and one of his earliest shining appearances is on the Roots' Rising Down album with Chrisette Michelle. And it's a monster cut. I mean, this is like phenomenal with regard to his lyricism and the go-go rap fusion that is his best incarnation as an MC. To me, you know, like to fuse the DC inflected go-go and to fuse the rap music has never been done. There are some DC rappers who had come through before, but Wale captures this because of his storytelling prowess, right? He's capable of telling those stories. But coming to your point, Rick basically says, without saying, you're gonna have to smack somebody to be on my label, right? You can't just be, you know, like, bookish rapper Wale, you know you got to, you know, huff. You know, you got to do some stuff in order to be on my label, right? And Wale has, you know, for two or three albums gone back and forth on this, you know, like whether or not he's going to be, you know, Rick Ross Jr. on an album or whether or not he's going to repudiate that and try to carve out that freedom that you're talking about. The reason I bring it up is because I think rappers are actually doing that now, right? Like this bears out your point. In the old days, they would have never done it, right? Like they would have been like, you know, like Lady of Rage, when... they said, I rock rough and tough with my Afro puffs. They'd be like, girl, you gotta say this. She said, yes, right, sure. What else do I need to say? Right? When Big told Kim, well, you gotta do this and you gotta take all your clothes off and you gotta do this, she said, yes. What else? Right? Now people are saying,
well, hold up.
Right? I'm not saying that I won't do that, but I'm gonna think about it. You know, and there is a little more space, and I think it's part of the music delivery model, right? Like the payoff is no longer as guaranteed and it's no longer as big as it once was. And the longevity, right? Like the difficulty of producing album after album, right? Because this is the real underappreciated message of Tupac's life, is that what, you know, part of what happened with Tupac with regard to his career anyway was sheer exhaustion, right? With fooling around with Suge. You know, he was basically just like, man, if I got to do another album like this, good. Go ahead.
And this is, thank you once again. But this is something that I've been noticing, the narrative, the certain things that don't get talked about, or if they do, kind of brush over it. And I guess I just want to know what your comment is. You kind of talked about in the beginning of your talk about women and the gay community. Mm-hmm. And then going back to the time when NWA, the biopic, blew up and it made news, but there were still stories of the women who were part of that story that weren't quite told. It was just kind of silenced, put to the side. And I like what's happening in the Middle East in terms of the hip hop culture. And there's a few artists that released an album under the title Arabs with Attitude. And it's an awesome track, it's really dope. But the thing that was missing was the female voice. And so I reached out to one of the artists through Twitter and I said, okay, so this is really dope what you guys just did, but where are the Arab women? Where are the artists from the Middle East who are women who also represent this culture? And he thought, I don't know, I didn't think about it. And he's like, well, if you can send me a list of these female artists, maybe we can do something. So I responded back with a name of specific artists that I'm familiar with. Shadia Mansour, British Palestinian, Miriam Sassi, who's Algerian but lives in Canada now, and a few other artists. And so he's like, okay, good, you got me. So I guess I just want to further that discussion of the others being othered, marginalized, and those voices that we don't necessarily get to hear from.
Thanks for the question. I'm just gonna speak real briefly on this. And just in relation to the NWA movie that came out this past summer, this is just my opinion. I think they made a huge mistake by removing the narratives of the women, and particularly, you know, Dr. Dre had, you know, some abusive relationships and some abusive encounters with women. For several reasons, it seemed like a really, really bad move. Not only does it paint a history, I mean, in this big pop format where, you know, such a convincing story because it's like pulling all the strings, and they know there are, you know, children, I mean, I'm saying like 15-year-olds, 16-year-olds, but very young people are going to see that film, and they're at that age where that just becomes their history of NWA, you know, and they don't have all the information that I grew up with just because I'm older, and, you know, I read all the articles, and that's what I did, but they're going to totally miss that. You know, and maybe some of it's coming back just because there was such a movement on social media to get that other information out. But the other mistake they made is that had they complicated those characters more, it would have actually been art, you know, which just seems like a big miss too for a bunch of guys who were making fantastic music at that time, were innovators, and now their footnote in history is that they have kind of, you know, the movie did what it needed to do as a Hollywood blockbuster, you know, but now it cannot be seen as pure art, you know, and maybe that's just my opinion. Maybe other people think it is, but it seems like on all levels, they made a huge mistake with that. And I hope that as more films come out, that start to look at hip hop and rap in a retrospective way, I hope people remember to keep it complicated and to keep the stories as full as possible. I know there's only so much you can do in 120 minutes, but people have done it. So that's all I got to say about that.
With regard to women in hip hop, when I was in Europe in the 1990s, so this goes back to this idea of, you know, one, how old I am, but two, you know, where I was with regard to the culture. You know, I was making albums in Scotland at the time and interacting with some MCs across Europe. And one of the things that came up and one of the things that comes up, I was at UCLA and somebody said, where are the women? Where are the women? And every study we've done finds that women are disproportionately represented in American hip hop. By disproportionate, I mean like 20%. Right? Like 20 out of 100%, you know, with no coercion, you know, no doctor in the sample, nothing. You talking about like 20%. And, you know, Chris will recall, you know, MC Light is probably one of the top 10 MCs of all time, right? Like in terms of mic skills, like when you just talk about pure mic skills, if you look at an album like Eyes on This, it's a monster album, right? And MC Lyte is fascinating because she comes from an insider family. You know, her brother is a producer. Her dad is a record label owner. You know, MC Lyte is the closest thing that we have to a person who was built to be an MC, like Tiger Woods was built to be a golfer, right? Like she was taught to project. There are stories of MC Lyte being like 3 or 4 years old and her daddy standing at the back of a room and her uncle standing at the back of a room and said, look, if you're going to be in this, you got to be in this. And I'm going to have to be able to hear you. You talk about somebody with enunciatory clarity. You talk about somebody with the capacity to pronounce at rapid pace almost anything, right? But coming back to the point, I think that international populations, especially the Middle East, right? Like in my familiarity with the Algerian community in Paris, particularly, this is where I saw more Middle Eastern rap. Women were 30-40% of the culture when you went to open mics. You know, they were 30-40% of the culture when you were in Cyphers. You know, like when you out there in Cyphers and you rapping, I'm like, oh, it's a lot of girls out here. And I think that in the United States, it's probably never gonna change, right? The irony is that the repressive realities for women in Middle Eastern culture, Toni Morrison said that sometimes when people force you into interior spaces, you gestate without being bothered. And I think in the United States, Nicki Minaj is the order of the day, right? Lil' Kim is the order of the day. This is the space that America has for a black female MC, right? Especially a commercially viable black female MC. And this has gone on from generation to generation, from Salt and Pepper to like MC Light, lyrically far more skilled, far more developed, but she just not, I mean, she can get roughneck, right? Like, you know, going back to the concessions that we're talking about, going back to the types of changes, the kinds of commercial moves that you have to make. So you look at a rapper like Mystic, coming out of LA, coming out of that the San Francisco area up there. I think you have voices that will emerge, but I think at the end of the day, the politics of sexuality in American society have pretty much ruined rap as an option for female MCs. It's not an overdetermining statement, but that's just my candid opinion. And I think that European MCs and Middle Eastern MCs have a far more, female MCs in those cultures have a far better shot of erupting as representative voices than they do in America for the reasons that Professor Berry was talking about earlier, is that, you know, like if we want to talk about, you know, like what you can do as a female MC is carry my bags. Right, like literally or metaphorically, right? Like, is that you can carry my bags, right? And that's what you can do. And when you're told that over and over again, and you're not developed, and you're not, you know, treated as an artistic equal, you know, they sing. that's what ends up happening is that people who might be MCs. I mean, Jill Scott probably could have been an MC, right? But she decided to sing, right? Yeah.
And I think Michael has just given us a great provocation for another Oberman conversation to follow up on that point. But let's thank them for having us.